Thank you. So we gather here today from Washington and Idaho. Anybody from Washington here? We gather here today as Muslim and Jew, as Christian and non-religious, as black, brown, white, young and old. And we stand together to raise our voices against the immigration ban issued by the president of this country. So this ban is irrational, it is unconstitutional, and it harms men, women, and children. And make no mistake, this is a religious ban. The seven nations that are banned from traveling here are majority Muslim, and the ban gives preferential treatment to non-Muslims. And so this is religious profiling. This is religious bigotry, and we need to say that. This is unjust, it is unloving, and it is un-American. It is wrong, and it will not stand. And so we take heart yesterday of the judge's ruling, and we celebrate today. Today's a day of celebration. And I just want to tell you something. In the last four cities in which I've lived, in Cincinnati and Chicago and Tucson and Minneapolis, they're all sanctuary cities. I just moved here from Pullman. I'm just saying. All right. And so we take heart. And we have a message. We have a message to share with our senators and representatives. That we don't want a ban, we don't want a wall, we want liberty and justice for all. The time has come for Congress to listen to the majority of the people of this land. The time has come to end the scapegoating and this irrational fear. One is more likely to be killed by a toddler with a gun than a terrorist in this country. We need to stop the fear-mongering. Since 9/11, about 800,000 refugees has come to this country, and not one, zero, has killed an American citizen. We need to stop the fear-mongering. Yeah! Out of the seven banned countries, for decades, of all the people that have moved here from those countries, none have killed an American citizen. We need to stop this fear-mongering. It is irrational. For years, over 11 million undocumented immigrants have lived, and they have worked in our fields, they have worked in our hospitals, our nursing homes, and our restaurants, and they have come here to escape violence and poverty, to find a better way of life for their families. And these immigrants are overwhelmingly law-abiding people. Yes. They contribute to society, they contribute to our economy, and they create more jobs than they take, folks. Yeah. They contribute, they pay taxes, yes. They pay into Social Security, yeah. Even though that many of them will never receive these benefits. Yeah. And so these men and women and children and their rich cultures are beneficial to this nation, and we need to stop the fear-mongering. Instead, we need to love our neighbor as ourselves. We need to love our immigrant neighbor as ourselves. We call upon our government to a higher standard. We call for humane borders and not bans and walls. We call for hospitality and not xenophobia. We call for less fear and more love. Yes. The purveyors of fear and scapegoating are tearing this nation apart, friends. And for the sake of us all, for the sake of our children and our children's children, this needs to stop. Yes. Not only is this a waste of our precious resources, not only is this immoral, but these policies simply incite more hatred and resentment. And they make us a less secure nation, and it has to stop. Yes. The hate speech and the bigoted policies lead to hateful actions and to deadly results. This past month alone, there have been 5 attacks on mosques in North America alone, including the horrific murder and the wounding of more in Quebec City by a white nationalist with an assault rifle. And the administration has been silent. This is shameful. This is a moral outrage. And we, the people, are here to say that we will not be divided. Last week, a mosque in Texas was burned to the ground by an arsonist, a cruel and cowardly act designed to intimidate and terrorize his faith community. Now that night, after their house of worship had been burned to the ground, members of the local Jewish community went to the imam's home. Now we're talking Muslims and Jews here. And they gave the imam the keys to the synagogue so that they would have a place to pray. Friends, this is the real America. We will not be divided. We will stand together, and we will not allow fear to govern us. We don't want a ban. We don't want a wall. We want liberty and justice for all. With me, we don't want a ban. We don't want a wall. We want liberty and justice for all. Again, we don't want a ban. We don't want a wall. We want liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Many religions, many faiths, one golden rule. That's what we stand for today. As well as our Constitution and the First Amendment. I'd like to introduce Elizabeth Stevens, minister of the Unitarian Universalist Church of the Palouse. Oh, we have an impact statement too. Impact's important.
I was excited to attend an important conference in Canada. This conference would have greatly benefited my research. Now I can't leave the country because I would not be able to return.
Wow. So these impact statements are written by people who were too afraid to speak aloud. Real people. So hello, friends. It's good to see some familiar faces, and it's even better to see more faces, new faces. The people of the Palouse, we rise to resist hate and bigotry. We rise for justice, we rise for kindness, we rise for human rights, and most importantly, we rise for one another.
That's right.
Now, when I was a little girl, my very favorite classroom job was called flag person. And this job consisted of leading the Pledge of Allegiance and choosing which patriotic song we would sing each morning. My little heart beats strong with love for my country. I was and I am deeply patriotic. Seeing veterans marching in their uniforms never fails to bring me to tears. Now, as I've grown and matured, I've had to face the dark side of this country's history. The slavery, genocide of indigenous peoples, Japanese internment camps. I understand these important stories to be a part of an epic battle between our highest ideals on one side and fear and greed on the other. Now, for most of my life, I have believed and hoped that those high ideals were winning. And so this executive order that tries to restrict travel and block immigration of refugees, it hurts my patriotic heart. I feel deeply, deeply ashamed. This is not who we are as Americans. We are a country that values fairness, and it just isn't fair to block travel, keep families apart, and put children in handcuffs just because of where they come from, the color of their skin, or where they worship. It's not fair. We are a country that is good. We are good people. And it is evil to turn our backs on folks trying to flee the war in Syria. This is perhaps the greatest humanitarian crisis of our times, and by virtue of our foreign policy, we are complicit in it. So it is evil to turn our backs, and we are not evil. We are a country that is brave. And we should not and cannot let fear drive us to act in ways that violate our deepest principles and drive us apart. Yes. The people who are impacted by this horrible executive order are innocent. They are mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, children, students, teachers, doctors, and they have done nothing wrong. Now, after 9/11, we were asked to take our shoes off in the airport, and we were willing. We were willing to have take our shoes off, to have our stuff x-rayed and picked through, willing to throw out drinks and toiletries, willing to wait in longer lines. Those are inconveniences, and we're willing to accept inconveniences in this country for the sake of safety. But I'm here to say we are not willing. We are not willing to allow racial profiling or unjust treatment of immigrants. Like my friend and colleague Steve, I'm deeply troubled by the rise of Islamophobia and hate crimes in our nation. The mosque burnings, the shooting in Quebec. These are tragic events. These are the terrorist attacks that we need to be working to prevent. So I want my Muslim neighbors and friends to hear and see and feel that here on the Palouse, you are welcome. And you are loved. And you are appreciated. And if ever you need our help, you just have to ask. As a human being and as a leader in the faith community, I promise you we will be there for you. I pray for you every day. Assalamu alaikum, peace be upon you, today and all days. Thank you.
We're going to ask two people to step forward, the next two immigrant statements to step forward, please. I'd like to remind you that today, people are standing in for their immigrant friends. These are real statements from immigrants in our community who are afraid to step forward. Yes. I speak for her. I was waiting for my husband to reunite with me after 1 year. I feel so shaken. I stand with her. I speak for her. My godson and mother were on their way to the U.S. I can't believe how easily we were torn apart. I stand with her. I'd like to welcome the youngest and longest sitting Pullman City Council member, Nathan Weller.
Thank you, Kimberly. Thank you, everyone, for being here and braving this cold weather. Two cities, Pullman and Moscow, two universities, WSU, University of Idaho. One community. One community. One region. This is the melting pot of the Northwest, always open and welcoming, which reminded me of Lady Liberty. Give me your tired, give me your poor, your brave masses yearning for more. Send me your intelligent, dreamers, your creative and hardworking. We welcome the caring and compassionate fleeing despots and war. Fear not, I am not a hardened soul, an angry fury, or a hateful ego. I open my heart, my mind, and my door. I am the spirit of a grateful nation and people. I think you could tell that was a little different. So, I want to tell you a story of my brother from another mother. He came here as the first in his family to become an American citizen. His parents came from Sudan on a work visa and a student visa. His dad was an engineer, worked with the DOD, NASA. His mom was a nurse. Jamal started serving in the Navy after 9/11 and has served 15 honorable years. He is my Muslim brother. His grandma and aunt often come to visit from Sudan. But what about now? Will he see them again? The day of the immigration ban, I walked out of my house with a heavy heart. I looked up, my neighbors had hung Trump signs on their chimney. I shook my head and walked on, but I remembered an elderly woman and immigrant that I took care of, saying, "It takes all types." Do not harden your hearts against others, immigrants, or those that disagree. Always be open, welcoming, and kind. Seek to understand so that you can be understood. Be the example you want in the world. With that, I'm going to close with something I wrote on Facebook in November before all of this craziness happened. Privileged white male. I am a young white American male. I came from a giving and loving family. I was raised believing that everyone is good inside and to be understanding of all people. I am fortunate and have a duty to provide opportunity and help others achieve as much or more than myself. I'm not afraid of the future, but I fear for others. I fear for my Muslim brother serving my country. I fear for my disabled sister struggling in life. I fear for my gay brother loving another. I fear for my sister forgotten and poor. I fear for my immigrant brother laboring for the future. At this point, my fears are mere illusions, worries without substance. But if harm comes to my brothers and sisters, I will stand, I will speak, and I will defend them. Not because I am an American, but because I am a human being. Yeah. Thank you for your time, attention, support, and solidarity. Keep moving forward.
We have another immigrant statement for someone who is too afraid to speak.
I speak for him. My father recently passed away. I can't attend his funeral and be with my family. It's really upsetting. I stand with him.
We are blessed on the Palouse to have an Islamic center, and we are blessed today to welcome from the Pullman Islamic Center, Imam Raid.
Thank you very much. My name is Raid Al-Sawair. I became the Imam for the Islamic Center in Pullman last year, but I used to be the Imam in the Seattle area for more than 10 years. So I am heartened by this amazing presence and support that we get from the community, majority of which is non-Muslim. So I thank you for coming and for being here today. I just wanted to say about the executive order of the president banning citizens of predominantly Muslim countries. These executive orders are unconstitutional. They are inhumane. And in the words of the Seattle district judge who ruled against it, it's causing irreparable damage and irreparable injury. And I believe that injury is not only against the state public universities and the tax base. It's more than that. I think the true harm is against all the beautiful values that this country represents. Yeah. These beautiful values are what many nations aspire to achieve, and many refugees in war-torn countries admire. This is what makes this country special. This ban separated children from their parents. It separated an Iraqi child who was injured during the US-led war, and his face was burned, and his parents were separated, and he is stuck in a children's hospital here. It separated a woman who is wheelchair-bound, diabetic, from her son, who was only a few feet away at the airport. This is so unjust and inhumane. This will not make America safe and only feeds and contributes into the agenda of the extremists. Yeah. With their theory is based on the clash of civilization. And they are using these executive orders to support their view. And they're saying that, look, that's exactly what we're saying all the time. So they're using these to recruit more people and to support their extremist agenda. Just want to conclude with one story that happened in the 8th century. This is a letter that was sent by a Muslim governor of one of the provinces of a Muslim country at the time. He sent it to the central Muslim government, and at the time, the leader of the Muslims, his name was Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He was known as the most just Muslim leader who ever, one of the most Muslim just leaders who ever lived. He wanted permission. This Muslim leader or the governor was in a province in northern Syria today. At the time, he was having lots of problems in the northern border. So he sent him a letter. He said, do I have your permission to build a wall to protect the northern border? So the Muslim leader sent him a letter back, and he said, protect your city with justice. Clear the streets of your city from oppression, and then you'll achieve peace. Yeah. Yeah.
This rally is about transforming our fear, our anger, into love. Yes. Yeah. And I want you to dig down and turn that anger into a loud voice for love. And you know what I'm going to say. When I say believers, you say yes. Yes. Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes!
Muslims?
Yes!
Jews?
Yes!
Christians?
Yes!
Sikhs?
Yes!
Atheists?
Yes!
Agnostics?
Yes!
Scientists?
Yes!
Hindus?
Yes!
Buddhists?
Yes!
Muslims?
Yes!
Yes! I'd like to introduce our next two speakers, Maureen Laughlin and Kate Evans. Maureen is the Voice of Social Justice Director, and Kate Evans, Associate Professor of Law and Director of the Immigration Clinic at the University of Idaho College of Law. Hi, everyone. So I don't have the honor of being a spiritual leader or a political leader, but I have the privilege of being a lawyer for immigrants. So last Friday, as we all know, President Trump signed an order that banned all students, all tourists, all teachers, all refugees, long-term immigrants entering the United States if they were from Libya, Yemen, Syria, Somalia, Iran, or Iraq. I represented people from all of those countries. It closed the doors to the United States to all those seeking protection here, and targeted refugees, targeted Syrian refugees in particular, with an indefinite ban. That night, Iraqis who supported the U.S. military were detained in U.S. airports. Long-term residents of the United States were not permitted to come home. Family members of refugees on their way to reunite with loved ones were stopped short. Students and teachers were blocked from completing their scholarship. Refugees who had passed 2 years worth of screening and security checks were turned away at our shores. And 60,000 visas to come to the United States were immediately revoked. But by Saturday morning, huge crowds of protesters stood up for refugees, for Muslims, for humanity in our refugee policy. Teams of lawyers and advocates got immigrants off the planes who were going to deport them, out of detention at the airports, and started fighting back in court. By Sunday, the Trump administration already had to abandon parts of its order. Longtime immigrants could return to the United States. Family members who had landed in the U.S. to join their parents, their children, their spouses were allowed to do so. Students and teachers on visas to study here were ordered out of detention, and courts all over the country started siding with refugees and immigrants. As the week progressed, the political pressure mounted, the court challenges multiplied, and the protests grew. By Friday, the Trump administration had backtracked further. Our Iraqi interpreters would be allowed in. Individuals from the seven countries could again become permanent residents. Refugees from those countries could seek protection for their loved ones. Individuals from those countries could again seek asylum from within. As of today, a court order in Washington has put a stop to the ban, forcing the government to allow refugees to come to the U.S. protection and allowing individuals from Libya, Syria, Yemen, Somalia, Iran, and Iraq to again enter the United States. Because of the outrage and the action of people across the country this past week, President Trump's own ban has been banned. But the many court orders are temporary, and political pressure is incredibly important to make the administration back down and ensure that our country serves as a refuge again. It's important to remember most of the Syrian refugees are women and children. The government itself has told Congress that no terrorist attacks have been committed by refugees. A ban on refugees is not what we need to keep our country safe. And this is also not the only fight for immigrants where your help is needed. In the Idaho legislature,
HB 76, a new bill, would force our local police to spend their time investigating each and every one of us for our immigration status. I love it. It will undoubtedly lead to racial profiling, to unconstitutional arrests, to unconstitutional detention, and we need help to stop this bill in its tracks.
We saw it once before!
I'll close by saying it's my greatest privilege as a lawyer to help someone fleeing from violence to find safety in the United States. I'm so glad to see everybody here speaking out and standing up so that our refugee neighbors know we're with them and the administration knows we're not. I hope we're at a turning point that will take this country away from policies based on fear and discrimination. And my colleague Maureen Laughlin, a longtime activist for peace and justice, is going to talk about how we can each do our part.
So let's be clear, I am not the face of social justice. We all are the face of social justice. And I don't know about the rest of you, but there are days when I lay in bed in the morning and think, I'm not getting up. I'm going to just put those sheets up on top of my head and I'm going to pretend this is not happening. Yep, that happens to all of us. And the answer is, they win every time we allow that to happen. And we cannot let that happen. We have to be the voices of social justice. That is our job. And as Kate was telling the story about all the things that have happened this week, it has been a roller coaster of good news and bad news. And the good news is people standing up for what is right and being the voices of social justice. We have to keep the pressure up. So my biggest fear is that we get lulled into where we are right now. We get a ban, it's a temporary ban. We have to keep the pressure up. And what we've also noticed is we've got a lot of executive orders still coming. And they're going to dribble them out and keep us under, just overwhelmed. So we can't let that happen to us. We must stay vigilant. We must keep the pressure up there, and we must make our voices heard.
Yes.
So what we have to do is think about how we keep our voices heard. We all do it really differently. We all can't be great immigration lawyers like Kate, who is welcome to our community here. We can't be ministers. We can't be all kinds. We are who we are. So you pick what it is that you do best.
Yeah.
And my answer is, you come to rallies. It is democracy in action. It's really, or you decide you join a group, proactive. One of the great things about the Palouse here is that people have really rallied. People have rallied, and it's really fun. We have proactive, we have upstanders, we have all kinds of them. One of the things that we have done is, we have a table over there that has a list of different groups doing different social justice work here. And we also want to make sure that if you have a group or you're interested in a group, please sign up or take literature on it. We all need to stay active, okay? We all need. And I look down here and I see everyone's causes and I think they're all worthwhile causes and we have to stay active. The other thing we have to do is think about the idea of running for office. Yeah, here we go. Make your voices heard. We need to. And if you don't have any other ones you want to do, at least donate money to people who are doing worthwhile things. You know, we wouldn't have the lawsuits we had unless people were supporting places like the Immigrants' Rights Community and also the ACLU and other groups.
Yeah.
Okay. The last one is write a letter to the editor. The most unlikely human beings are now writing letters. I will tell you that a former justice of the Idaho Supreme Court wrote a letter to the editor about how wrong this executive order is. Not only did he do that, he went on TV and talked about it, and he ended saying that he was starting a pro bono free assistance program for refugees in this state. And lastly, talk to people. Talk to each other. And I guess I sit there and I think, we need to keep the dialogue going. And there are great groups out here. And I see Kathy out here right now. Kathy Dawes right there waving her hand. Legislative action. I mean, she is a voice of legislative action that woke up on New Year's Day and said, you know what? We have to do something. And if you have any questions about what's happening, Kathy puts out a newsletter all the time, an email that lists what are the white pages on this, who to contact, what the telephone numbers are, and exactly what action you can do. Now, don't be mistaken by some of this stuff, because I personally spent 5 phone calls last weekend trying to call O'Brien's office to give my opinion on the ACA. What did I get? A 2-minute verbiage on why the ACA is a bad thing, and then it pushed the button 1 if you actually want to weigh in on the survey. Every time, his voice, the box was full. So, guess what? My voice wasn't really heard, but you have to be persistent and stick with it. So there you go, Kathy. Okay, she's got a way to reach him. So my answer is, I got a couple of statements and I'm going to end here. And one is, please go over and pick up information on Voices for Social Justice. The beginning of this week, we will actually have a web page up that lists every organization. And I'll tell you, we take no claim to having all of them, so make sure you add your name to that list. And also, I want to say, keep up the pressure. Another thing is, educate yourself. On February 15th, the University of Idaho College of Law is actually sponsoring, with a few other people, a whole program on immigration. Do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, we'll have voices from undocumented students talking about their experience in these times. The legal director from the ACLU will join us, and Maria Andrade, a longtime advocate and leader in the immigration community, will be talking about what's going on right now and what we can do.
So grab a flyer, be active. Remember, we are the Voices for Social Justice.
We stand up today for religious freedom. We stand up today for the Constitution of the United States of America. We stand here today for the First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. We have a statement now from somebody in absentia, somebody else who was afraid to come forward publicly.
I speak for her. I was scheduled to start my postdoc in February at WSU. I'm in Germany to defend my PhD dissertation. I'm not sure what I should do. I stand with her.
I'd like to introduce right now the chair of the Moscow Human Rights Commission, Ken Fonks. Ken.
Thank you. It's great to see all of you here. This is a great crowd, and it's wonderful and inspiring to see all of you. And so those of us at the Moscow Human Rights Commission want you to know that we are here for you. And so we are here today against the ban. We're here today to support our Muslim friends and neighbors. We're here to support all our immigrant friends and neighbors. Now this ban, as has been said before over here, this ban is racist, It is Islamophobia, and it is unjust. And it is clearly anti-Muslim when we have Idaho representatives saying we need to make sure that we exempt Christians from this ban. So, it's obvious where this is directed at. It is also because it is directed at refugees, people who are suffering greatly, who just want a safe place to be. This ban is immoral and un-American. Now, I am also a historian. I'm a historian at WSU, and I know the United States has a long, dark history of racism, of discrimination, of anti-immigrant nativism, of bigotry. And so this is not the first time this has happened. Not even close. We have had these types of selective bans against the Chinese, the Japanese, other Asian immigrants, of our Latino brothers and sisters, against our people from Eastern and Southern Europe, from our Jewish immigrants. Again and again and again, we've had these types of bans. But it is time now to stand up and say, enough! We will not accept this anymore! We are better than this! We have to be better than this! So it is time to continually stand up right now to support our Muslim neighbors, our friends, our colleagues, all immigrant friends and colleagues and neighbors. Yes. Now, we've had a couple of weeks that have been pretty tough here. Kind of a dark couple of weeks. And there is more coming. That's to be expected. However, the white supremacists who have infiltrated our government want to wear us down. They want to overwhelm us. They want to use hate and fear to divide us. We cannot let that happen. We have to stand together so that if any of us are becoming overwhelmed, tired, burnt out, there are others there to help us, to support us, so that we can carry forward. We can only do this together. As a community, we have to work together and help each other, not be divided. So this is a start. So we support our Muslim neighbors and friends, but we also have to continue to support the water protectors of Standing Rock. Yeah! We have to stop the discrimination against the LGBTI community and support our neighbors there. We have to say no to this ridiculous idea of a wall. Yes! So we have to stand up for those who are homeless, who are living in poverty, who are about to lose their health care. We have to stand up for all of it together. Because only together can we bring light to the darkness. Only together can we move forward to make our community, our states, our country, and the world a better place to live. So please join me and stand together against everything, no matter what your religion, your race, your gender, sexual orientation, identity, everything. Stand together. There's so many lists, I can't go them all. Stand together, because that is the only way we can make America true to its values. Thank you.
To see everyone today, and it's also wonderful that young people are standing up and learning about their government and learning that they have power. We have power together. And together we will overcome. We will overcome. I'd like to introduce a young, energetic warrior, Hannah Krause, Palouse Upstanders.
That might be the best introduction ever. Wow, every time I come up here, I always wonder why I do this, because it's a little scary, I have to say.
But, you know, I think it's really important to be heard and say all the things that are just happening that are wrong. And I think we've all heard that those who failed to learn from history were doomed to repeat it again. Yet as I watch the news and I hear the things that are happening, I think it's pretty clear that we are repeating history. The majority of us are here as Americans simply because our forefathers, hundreds of years ago, they came to America. They saved us from some of the things that our refugees have to deal with. We don't have to worry, is a bomb going to fall on our house? We don't have to worry if enemies are going to come and take us away from our homes. Well, not yet. So I think it's really important, you know, we can love who we want, we can worship how we wish, all because our ancestors came to America. So I've been lucky enough, I live all over the United States, I've traveled the world, I've met thousands of people, asked millions of questions. Anyone that knows me, I'll probably talk your ear off and ask you lots of questions. But through all of these travels, what I've learned a few things. And I will say that regardless of skin color, we are all one. Yeah. Regardless of gender, sexual identification, we are all one. Yeah. Regardless of political affiliation, and I know not everyone agrees with this, but we still are all one. Yeah. Regardless of your country, your religion, we are all one. We are all human, and we all deserve a chance at a better life. Yes. Since 1886, the Statue of Liberty has welcomed immigrants at the end of their long journey as a symbol of freedom and a promise of a new life. At its base, a poem by Emma Lazarus, a descendant of Jewish immigrants, the New Colossus. Not like the brazen giant of Greek fame, with conquering limbs astride from land to land, here at our sea-washed sunset gate shall stand a mighty woman with a torch, whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name Mother of Exiles. From her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome. Her mild eyes command the air-bridged harbor that twin cities frame. Keep ancient lands, your storied pomp, cries she with silent lips. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. While this is not legislature, this is the core of America, and we must remember, we are all one. Yeah.
Okay, people, dig down one more time, because you know what? We got to pick that hate, we've got to take the negativity, and we got to turn it into love. So you know what I'm going to ask you to do? I'm going to ask you to say yes. Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Muslims.
Yes.
Jews.
Yes.
Christians.
Yes.
Sikhs.
Yes.
Atheists.
Yes.
Agnostics.
Yes.
Hindus.
Yes.
Buddhists.
Yes.
Religious freedom.
Yes.
Religious freedom.
Yes.
That's what I thought you'd say. And now, somebody's going to give a voice. In fact, two people are going to give a voice to people who are afraid to speak.
I speak for her. I was going to finally see my parents after 4 years, but now that won't happen. I stand with her.
Well, here we are again in just 2 weeks. I think this is becoming a new normal. We gotta keep standing up and resisting. Protesting and resistance is becoming the new normal with this administration. There's a lot to say no to, and a lot of new direction we need to go into, and I love this sign, ban, ban, and not immigrants. He does not deserve to be on the National Security Council. Your senators need to hear from you. There are lots of people being appointed to positions that don't deserve those positions, and they need to hear from you constantly. Your president and your new president needs to hear from you that this is not okay. And now, we saw last night in the news that your governor needs to hear from you. That is unacceptable for the governor of this state to pronounce that we're going to have some, that we need to have some kind of religious preferences for travel to the United States. That's not okay, and that's not American. That's not what we stand for in this country. No, it's not. There is. That's right. I have this statement that I'd like to read, and I will speak for him. My wife and I got married a month ago. I left Iran for Pullman earlier, as the visa process took longer for my wife. I am not sure when I will see her again. I stand with him.
I'd like to introduce to you an Iranian immigrant working at WSU, Shireen Shahsevand.
Hi, everyone. I wish I had actually gone first because all these great speakers kind of, you know, it's very hard to go after them. But here I am, an Iranian immigrant, standing up for what I believe in and what I think is very unfair. So before I start, I would like to thank every one of you for standing here with us today. Every one of you inspires me. Every one of you gives us hope. I cannot begin to express my gratitude to those who've made this rally happen. Becky and Kimberly, if you raise your hands. Well, Becky's here, Kimberly's there. I don't know what to say to you except that I will always be indebted to you for your kind hearts, for your generosity, for your support, and of course for meeting with me on a Sunday night at the food co-op. Thank you, Palouse Proactive. Thank you, Upstanders. Thank you, the Unitarian Universalist Church of the Palouse. Thank you, Elizabeth Stevens, for inspiring us all. Thank you, Adam Hearts of Pullman, for donating this great speaker system. I love it. Thank you, the Peace Band, for your wonderful, beautiful music. Thank you, Tom Hansen, for capturing memories. This is going to be great. So you will all see on our Facebook page the photos that Tom has captured, and I'm sure they're already, some of them are already there.
Tom!
Thank you. Thank you, Kate Fox Amato, for your beautiful poster that you see there. I would also like to thank WSU and U of I for standing for their international students, for their immigrant family. Thank you. I'd like to thank WSU student groups who helped greatly in publicizing this event and offered their support along the way. Iranian Student Association, Unity at WSU, who Sydney Johnson is not here today, but they're great. If you're part of WSU, make sure you go to their meetings. It's amazing what they do. The Crimson Group, the Muslim Student Association, I have Vidad here with us, and she's the president of the Muslim Student Association. And I also want to congratulate everyone on our victory last night. That was a historic moment. Thank you, Governor Jay Inslee. Thank you, Attorney General Bob Ferguson. Thank you. So I want to start by talking about who the real immigrants are. And unlike what we are usually portrait on TV, I want to give you some examples. We have about 300 students and faculty members here in Poland and Moscow alone, from those 7 banned countries only. Now, these immigrants, they work hard, they contribute to science, and they contribute to U.S. economy. And they win national awards, they publish publications. So they are contributing every day. On the national level, these immigrants from the banned countries have won field medals. They have won awards in arts and science. They have worked for NASA building Mars rovers. They have worked tirelessly in labs to find a cure for cancer. They have founded successful companies, and they have helped American economy grow. And of course, they've paid taxes and they fought in our army more than what we can say about some people in the White House. Despite all the sadness and anger that the executive order created this past week has restored my faith in humanity. And let me tell you why. When I heard about the ban, I was devastated, I was angry, I was sad. At one point, we actually looked into moving back to Canada, which was our home for 6 years. Then I turned on the news and I saw people, American or not, showing up at the airports to support their immigrant brothers and sisters, to support refugee families, and to support their Muslim neighbors, just as you're doing today. Lawyers lining up to help them pro bono. Then I looked around myself and I saw the police community standing with me. That gave me hope, and that reminded me why I chose this great country as my home. That reminded me what one person or what one group of people says and does not make America what it is. It is the love, the kindness, the compassion, the respect, the inclusivity, the acceptance that make America what it is. And let me tell you, America is great. Someone actually advised me that speaking here today might cause some trouble for me, and they may be right. I thought about it a lot, and I realized a lot of us have chosen this great country because we were tired of living in fear. Fear of not being able to speak up. Fear of not being able to express our concerns. And fear of not being able to raise our voices. If raising my voice here today, if exercising my First Amendment right, if speaking up for my immigrant and refugee brothers and sisters is something that's going to get me into trouble, then let that be. The America that silences its people, it would not be the America that I want to live in or raise my kids in. To all my Iranian friends, to all my friends from the 7 banned countries, to all my Muslim friends, to all my undocumented friends, to all my LGBTQ friends, to all my American friends, I salute you and I stand with you. I know what a rough couple of weeks we've all had. And your being here shows that we are ready to fight this. We will not stand quiet. We will not let them take our rights away. And we will emerge stronger than ever, just as we already have. My immigrant and refugee brothers and sisters, we can fight this injustice. Just look around you. You are surrounded by love and kindness. And if there is one thing that I want you to feel in your heart today, it is that love, kindness, and compassion still exist in this world. Thank you all. to, thank you so much. I would like to end my speech with a poem from Martin Niemöller. It's about the Second World War and the Nazis. First, they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me. Thank you.
You know what to say. Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Muslims.
Yes.
Jews.
Yes.
Christians.
Yes.
Sikhs.
Yes.
Atheists.
Yes.
Agnostics.
Yes.
Scientists.
Yes.
Hindus.
Yes.
Buddhists.
Yes.
Religious freedom.
Yes.
Religious freedom.
Yes.
Yes. The signs. Okay, we have somebody who wants to say something about the signs.
Hi, I'm a geology graduate student, and I just like to clarify that science is not a belief. It is either something you understand or you don't understand, and if you don't understand, I encourage you to educate yourself.
Believing in scientific method, that would just too long to say. So, I believe in scientific method!
Yeah.
You know, there's one rule, the golden rule. Jesus, Muhammad, and Buddha all believed in the form of the golden rule, did they not? The Dalai Lama took it one step further. He believes in the law of one. We are all one. When one is harmed, all are harmed. When one are helped, all are helped. And together, we will get through this, and we will carry on, and we will be stronger than ever. Thank you for coming today, and thanks to the speakers and everybody who's standing up for the America we love. Some things you can do today. Go get a drink at Cafe Artista. They're donating 20% of today's proceeds to the International Rescue Committee to support refugees and immigrants. Come see representatives from Palouse Proactive and Palouse Upstanders by the stage. For more information,
State Representative Paulette Jordan.
Paulette Jordan is here.
Thank you. You guys are awesome. So thank you all for being here. Actually, I want to apologize for being a little late. I had a town hall. I'm doing town halls all day today.
Yeah.
But thank you all for standing together. That's why Moscow is so amazing. I am doing my best. We have some problems. We have an issue with the bill that's actually coming up in State Affairs Committee strictly to address this issue. But I believe that the rights belong to the local communities, and that's why we have to fight for our sanctuary cities. So thanks for being here. Please continue to speak up and reach out to your representatives. Your voice is what matters most. So that's all I have to say, but I just want to, again, just appreciate every single one of you who are standing up for our friends, our relatives, our businesses, our agricultural communities, everyone that's reliant upon immigrants who are doing their jobs here, who are investing in our local communities. all good people, and it really does come down to having compassion, empathy, not just at the local level, but at the state level and at the national level. So well done. Thank you, and love you all.
There's a letter writing campaign tomorrow. It's going to be at the Palouse Mall starting at 2 o'clock. It's family friendly. So bring your family, show up right next to Macy's at the Palouse Mall tomorrow. You're all welcome. There's also a table here. Jeffrey Ramsey is sharing letters, powerful letters, and you can share those now. And
I brought this as a reminder that we really are one, and that those lines that you usually see on these things are just a story that we tell. Yeah! If any of you would like to have your picture taken holding the world in your hands, I'll be up here by the stage when we're done.
So learn about the activities going on and talk to your neighbors. We have a little group, the Palouse Action League. It's a Facebook group, but we're sharing photographs and short testimonials, so take a testimonial. We are all together in this. We are all one. When one is harmed, all are harmed. And we have a song.